ensure that you are paying attention to the exits. There are 5 exits here, so if anything happens, and I hope that it does not, you know exactly where to go. All right, so the other thing that I want to talk about is the calendar. So, let me find that calendar. You are handed this calendar, and it outlines each week what we're going to focus on. So we're going to have 3 weeks where we focus on reading, comprehension, and math. The next week, we'll be studying or working on ability to learn and apply information and situational judgment. That will be for 3 weeks. If you are coming on a Monday, you know that you're going to have a makeup day on Fridays. That's going to be on, we have September 11th, I'm sorry, and then we have another makeup day on 10-2. So understand that if you're coming on Tuesday, as today, you're welcome to come any other days, okay? But we're going to be repeating the information, right? But you're welcome to come as many times as you like. All right, that pretty much does it for our welcome. We're going to get started with our reading comprehension. And what I'm going to do is have you turn to page 18. And you are going to be timed for a little bit. I'm going to give you about 5 minutes to read the paragraph on page 18 and answer those 4 questions. And then we're going to talk about some strategies afterwards. So you just got done doing a timed reading. And so what we're going to do is just talk about some strategies. What I want you to do on your own is to read multiple choice test-taking strategies. That is on page 9. It states what to do if more than one answer seems correct. So I want you to review that. And then we're going to move on and discuss choosing the right answer. Choosing the right answer is on page 10. And we're going to start with that. General test taking strategies for multiple choice tests. And it begins with making predictions. Okay? So I'm going to give you a moment to review page 9. All right.
So we're going forward and we're doing make predictions. Your mind is typically the most focused immediately after you have read the question and digested its contents. At this point, try to predict what the correct answer will be. Scan the answer to see if your prediction is one of the choices. If it is, you can be quite confident that you have the right answer. Check the other answers to be sure, but most of the time, you've got it. Okay? So don't be afraid to make predictions. Here we go again. Answer the question. Make sure you understand it. And answer to the best answer that is answering the question. So it says, this may seem obvious, but test writers create some excellent answer choices that are wrong. Don't pick an answer just because it sounds right or you believe it to be true. So it sounds contradictory, right? If they trust your gut, right? And then they say, don't do that. But they want you to double check. Make sure you understood what you read, and then you understand the question, okay? Alright, so let's just go over that again. This may seem obvious, but test writers create some excellent answer choices that are wrong. Don't pick an answer just because it sounds right or you believe it to be true. It must answer the question. Don't choose an answer that is factually true, but it's an incorrect choice because it does not what? Answer the question, okay? Alright, in this area, last but not least, once you've made your selection, go back and check it against the question. Make sure you didn't misread the question and that your choice does answer the question posed. Now, let's say that a bunch of times, right? So what should you do? Answer the question. Make sure you read it correctly and answer the question, right? Okay, so let's move on. Using a benchmark. So that's a fancy way of saying the process of elimination. Okay, so let's just go through it so you can get a better understanding. Okay?
So you all have experience with process of elimination, right? So you always choose an answer that seems good, right? And then you gotta weigh all the other answers against that standard. And if you find one better, then of course you keep that one out. So that's all this is saying, is that using a benchmark, okay? Valid information. Remember that all the information in the question is valid and may be needed to determine the correct answer. This is not true for all the information in the answers. They are designed to distract you and frequently contain superfluous information. If it appears that two unrelated topics are discussed in the question, don't ignore either one. If you first determine the relationship between the topics, then you will be better able to answer the question correctly. So I'm going to stop and go in here. I'm going to jump around a little bit. So when I read that, I used the word superfluous. Who knows what the word superfluous means? No? Hold on.
All right, then we move on to
Another one of the strategies that they tell you with vocabulary building is to study the prefix, right? So, like for I am. I am as a prefix, right? If I wrote incompetent, right? In means not. So incompetent means you're not confident, right? So all that is if you get more comfortable understanding prefixes and suffixes, what those mean, then you can break down the word and kind of understand it without really understanding it. So that's another strategy that people teach people that are going to take the SAT or the GRE or whatever the case may be. They tell you to study the prefix and suffix, okay? So again, don't run away from difficult words. If you see them, you know, try to learn a few, okay? Next, we're going to move on. I think this is still going on for difficult words, okay? It says, notice words like can, will, often, rarely, etc. Often the answer choice will be wrong because it doesn't contain these words, but has definitive words like exactly and always, which leaves no room for exception. Last one says, be alert for switchback words such as but, although, nevertheless, which indicate a shift in thought and alter the nature of the question. All right, so we went through difficult words. There's more of difficult words, but I didn't use it. I'm using this as a separate book, trying to align the pages. Yeah. Oh, difficult questions. I'm sorry. Okay, so difficult questions. Don't waste too much time on questions that appear too hard or difficult. Try to identify and obviously incorrect answers and guess at the remaining answer choices before giving up. Brainstorm each possible choice independently from the other choices. Ask yourself if it is possible that it could be the correct answer. When you systematically go through each answer, you are often able to discover things you might have overlooked by only scanning the answers. All right, new information. Correct answers or correct answer choices will rarely have new information included. If new information is included that doesn't seem to relate to the topic being asked about, then that choice is likely incorrect, even if the rest of the answer is correct. You gotta go back to contextual clues. Look for and understand the context of the question. More than one answer may look right, but one will fit the context better. Phrases. Be aware of answers that repeat word for word a portion of the question. It's usually a wrong answer. Most correct choices paraphrase a point. Scientific sounding choices are better than ones using slang language. Okay? So with that, that was a lot of information. And of course, we have these books to review them again. What I want you to do now is go to page 18. You have another 7 minutes to do that paragraph along with numbers 1 through 4. I'm sorry. Hold on 1 second. No, I'm sorry. Reading comprehension set 2. That's on page 21. And you have 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. 5 questions. So you get 7 minutes for that. Page 21. Alright, what time? Does anybody need a minute more? Everybody okay? Yes? Okay, so let's quickly go over the answers. Alright, so for number 5, we have it is most accurate to state that the author in the preceding selection presents what? I hear D. Did you guys do anything different this time around? So you started to read the question first before you read the paragraph, yes? Absolutely, that's a great strategy, okay? I have a teacher friend who taught reading for a long time, and so she teaches the adults the same thing. Read the question before you read the paragraph, okay? So he tried something different, which was to read the question first. Anybody do anything else different? Awesome. So he said he practiced more of the process of elimination. All right, anyone else do anything different? You kind of need to feel good with the strategies that you had before coming in here, right? And that's fine. All right, so all I'm going to ask you to do is make sure you review everything that we went over, right, in your own private time, and make sure that you have a solid strategy before you go in to take the test on October 10th. You know the test is October 10th, right? So I like to tell my students the 5 P's. Before I start the school year, I do the 5 P's. What are the 5 P's? Proper preparation prevents poor performance. All right, that was, I can't remember who the original quote came from, but it had to do with sports. But it applied to all of us, right? We can't go in hoping and praying and wishing that things will turn out the best. So what we're going to do is practice and prepare ourselves, which is why we're here, right? So the other thing is, one of the skills that you can use when you're reading is skimming, right? Or scanning, okay? And I'm going to give you 2 minutes to scan some information. All right, so I'm going to have you turn back to page 15, 16, and 17. All right? You are going to scan those 3 pages and come up with some things that you can do to help prepare yourself before October 10th when it comes to reading. Okay? How would you prepare yourself for reading, scan those pages, and come up with a couple points about what to do to prepare yourself before October 10th when it comes to reading? 2 minutes. All right, that was 2 minutes to just scan or skim those few pages. Who can tell me, give me some advice on how to prepare for a reading exam? Give me something. Not really though, because it's share with you is another strategy called chunking. So I'm going to pass this out now, okay?
And what I want to give
6, okay? So hang tight. Alright, so how many people came prepared with a calculator today? No. Okay. And that's okay. So what I'm going to say is, we're going to review the calculator policy. Alright, the calculator policy states, candidates will be advised on their admission notice whether or not calculators are permitted. And what I'm told it is not. Oh, well, I mean, calculators, I'm told, will be permitted. But it's the type of calculator that you're allowed to use, okay? But you'll be getting updated information as we move forward. If calculators are permitted, they must be quiet, handheld, solar, or battery powered. Devices with typewriter keyboards such as computers, spell checkers, personal digital assistants, address books, language translators, dictionaries, and any similar devices are prohibited. Depicted on this sheet are examples of permitted and not permitted calculators. So on the front we have pictures of the permitted calculators. Pictures below are two examples of calculators that are permitted. The one to the left, it states, this calculator is very simple. It adds, subtracts, multiplies, divides, does square roots, and has never. It has no alphabet on it. The calculator to the right states, this calculator is an example of a scientific calculator. These may have an alpha option for some keys. An alphabetic letter may appear in a variety of positions. All right, so you see the picture of this. It says, see reverse side of calculators that are not permitted. So on the back side, calculators that are not permitted. Any devices with keyboards set up like a typewriter are not permitted. This is an example of a typical typewriter keyboard. And so you're going to pay close attention to the directions to monitor this, okay? This is where you want to pay attention. Should candidates have calculators that are not permitted, advise them that they must either put them away or you will complete a critical incident report to Albany where the possibility of disqualification will be determined. If a critical incident report needs to be completed, indicate the candidate's name, social security number, exam number, describe the situation, and if possible, describe the device. Do you want to go for that? No. So, what do you do? I'm trying to find my calculator. And of course, I can't find it. All right, I have a little calculator, right? Go with that. So essentially, don't take your cell phone in there, try to use the it's not permitted, right? Any of them, so you have the whole list here, what's not permitted. So what do? You just go to Staples, Office Max, Target, wherever, TJ Maxx. I'm sure that they will have some simple calculator, solar or battery power, that you get so that you will have that going in the test on October 10th. Correct? No problems. Now, today, because you didn't know that you're going to need a calculator, if you need to, as we're going through some of the math problems, you can use your phone, but that's only for today. No more. Right? Because I don't like to get a student doing something and get in the habit of doing that and then expect that they can do it on the test. So today only, because you don't have a calculator on you, and when we go through the math problems, you can use your phone. Right? I need to see some smiles in your eyes. Let me know you understand. Yes? Okay, today only, no more, right? Okay, so now, let's go ahead and have your basic arithmetic booklet. All right, so what we're gonna basic arithmetic.
So it says, this section requires candidates to use basic arithmetic. What is that? Add, subtract, multiply, divide. To find the missing value in a table of numbers, candidates will not need to refer to the training lesson or any other section of the test to answer the questions in this section. All information needed to answer each question will be contained in this section. No knowledge of firefighting or any other job is required. Candidates should bring a handheld battery or solar power calculator for use on this test. Candidates will not be permitted to use the calculator function on their what? Cell phone. Okay? Test pass. Questions in this section will present numeric information in a table with some values missing and ask candidates to calculate the missing value using basic arithmetic functions. Candidates may write in a test booklet and/or use a calculator for this section. Quiet, handheld, solar or battery-powered calculators are permitted. Cell phones and devices with typewriter keyboards are strictly prohibited. So, they're saying it over and over again so that you get those cell phones. Okay? So, I am going to give you 3 minutes, and if you need more time, I'll give it to you, but 3 minutes to find out the missing value on that chart. But before we do that, let's do this. Before we do that, there's a chart here. How would you approach a chart? What should you do first of all? I mean, something very simple. What should you do? Read everything about getting familiar with the chart, right? Before you start doing anything, right? Okay, so the value of the chart and then fill in the missing values, okay? 3 minutes. Does anybody need any more time? 1 minute? No? Okay. So typically, you know we've already talked about reading the questions before you tackle something, right? But because I know the answer is on the next page, I don't want to prime you with the answers, right? I don't want to do the work. Okay. So if you flip the page up to number 4, page 4, we will see that it says sample question 1. What number should be entered in the table in place of missing value triple A? What you guys put? Well, the answer is there. Did you guys get 13? B? Okay. For sample question 2. So again, if you didn't get B, then you would just look for the explanation as to why it is 13. All right, and so sample question 2 says, what number should be entered into the table in place of missing value triple B? What'd you guys get? C is correct. C is correct. All right, and so you see that the answer right there and with the explanation. All right, next you will notice that there is a page with a lot of mathematical terms, right? And so I want you to get familiar with that. I'm not going to read all of them, but you should know terms that are related to addition, terms that are related to subtraction, multiplication, and division. All right, so go through that. I'm going to give you a minute to do that, okay? And then we're going to go on to some more problems. All right, so hopefully you have an opportunity, maybe you jogged your memory about what big words are used for addition, what words are used for subtraction, division, right? Because those will come up in word problems, and so you need to be familiar with all of those words. Alright, next we're going to move on to page 6. It's another chart, and so what I typically like to do is to talk to all of my students about what types of things you will find in this workbook. So, a few things that I discovered, of course, because I had to do it myself, right? Is that you need to know how to find the mean or average. So you guys okay with mean and average? Percentages, proportions, okay? Those are some of the things that are in here. We have some algebraic equations in here, all right? So I will warn you that one of those things are gonna pop up on this particular page. So on page 9,
again, you were evaluating the number of arsons by year. Number one says the total number of arsons that took place from 1995 through 2008. So first, before you give me the answer, what word in that word problem tells you what operation you're supposed to use? Total, right? So total lets us know that it's addition. So we're adding up all of those numbers, all of the arsons. So what is your answer for number one? B is correct. There were 16,210 arsons between 1995 and 2000. Number two, it says, what is the average number of arsons per year from 1995 to 2000? So before you give me the answer, what is the key word in that word problem that lets you know what operation or what method you should use to answer the question? What is it? Average, all right? So how do we find the average? We have to add up all of the data and divide by the number of numbers. I hate saying that because it sounds so, it's like a tongue twister, right? Add up all of the data points and divide by the number of numbers that you have, okay? So all of the data points you have, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 numbers, and so we're adding all of those and dividing by 6, correct? So what answer did they give? B is correct. 2,702 arsons, average arsons, okay? And so number three, it says how many more arsons occurred in 1999 than in 1998? So before you answer, what word or words did you look at to tell you what operation you should use? How many more? So we know that we're comparing. There's a difference there. So we know that we are subtracting, right? So what answer did you get? A is correct. So it was 1,686 more arsons in 1999 than 1998. All right, so let's move on to the next chart on page 7. It says questions 4 through 6 are based on the following table. It says a homeowner who recently lost many of her possessions in a fire is trying to estimate the value of lost items. Below is a list of some of the lost items and their approximated values. So there are 3 questions there. I'm going to give you a minute per problem and then we'll talk about it. So you get started.
More expensive than the original, how much would it cost?
We have another chart. This chart says, the following is a list of firefighters and their respective heights and weights. Alright, so we have all the firefighter names, their height, and their weight. And so you have six problems all related to that chart. So I am going to, because I think some of them are a little easy to do, I'm going to give you 4 minutes, because I think you only need like 30 seconds for a couple of those answers. So 4 minutes for those six questions.
That is correct. B is a boy. All right, number 14.
In which grade do the fewest students take Spanish?
D is correct. D is the goal.
12th grade.
All right. 15. Which elective has the greatest enrollment of 11th graders?
I'm here a couple different.
B?
B. It's B.
B, driver's education.
What you guys got?
Okay, good.
All right.
And so last but not least, we have 16. What is the value of A?
D is correct.
So now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to direct us to the back of the book because I know that you guys are going to do some work at home. All right, and so the answers are included in this book. And I want to say it's page 31. Page 31. Okay? So you have your answers and explanations. All right, so if you're going through, I've got it here on 16, I think the one that we just did. It says the answer is B, but we know it's D. Okay? So you make that correction on page 35. 16, the answer is D. Okay? It has B, but it's D. D is a boy. I mean, D is a dog.
Two is correct. And your answer, in the answers in the back. Before you start that, let me ask you a quick question. What information do you need to know in order to answer that question? The degrees of a triangle, which is what? So the sum of all the angles for a triangle is 180 degrees, okay? So go ahead, take 30 seconds and answer that question. Number 40. Okay, that was the 30 seconds. Were you able to calculate it? Yeah, so what's the missing angle? Four or D, all right? 80 degrees is the missing angle for that triangle. All right, let's move on to number 41. All right, so I'm just going to warn you, you might have a different strategy to solve this, but I want you to think about proportions. Proportions is what's needed to answer number 41. So I'm going to give you a full minute, okay, to answer that one, and then we'll talk about it. Time flies by quick, right? 1 minute. Are you guys okay with that one? No? Okay, we're going to do that. Okay, so one of the things that you need to know in order to solve that problem is not listed. What do you think you need to know to solve that problem that's not there? That's not there. Yes. You need to know how many ounces are in a pound. And who can tell me how many ounces are in a pound? How many ounces are in a pound? 16. Okay. And it says, if 5 ounces is equal to 140 grams, then 2 pounds of ground meat is equal to how many grams? So what they're asking you to do is to evaluate and to convert, right? So we're dealing with 5 ounces is equal to 140 grams. So I mentioned to you a proportion. So what we can do is, we can take the measure that we have here, and we can set up ounces to grams. Okay? And then, what we're going to do is, we're going to fill in our 5 here for the ounces, and our 140 grams here. And we're trying to figure out what 2 pounds is equal to in grams, correct? 2 pounds, right? But guess what? We can't use pounds in this proportion, right? So that's why we have to go here and convert. So we need to convert our pounds to ounces so that we can figure that out, okay? So what do? We have to take 16 times 2, because we said that there is 16 ounces per pound, right? So we have 2 pounds, so we have to multiply. So we have 32 ounces, right? So now we're going to plug that here, 32 ounces. And what are we looking for? We're looking for grams. So that's our unknown. Does that make sense? Okay. So now what we do when we have proportions, we don't multiply going across, we multiply going in diagonals. So that's called cross multiplication. Okay? So that means that we have to, let's go this way. And we have 5x. So that just simply means 5 times some number is equal to 140. Times 32. So here's where you're going to whip out your calculators and help me out. Okay. Or I'm going to have to do a long hand. So tell me what 140 times 32 is.
4480.
So what do? We undo multiplication with division. Yes? So we're going to divide here. Right? And what we do on the side, we have to do on the side. So what do we just do? We created a fraction. All fractions are division problems in disguise, right? So we're going to take 2480 and divide it by 5. So grab out your phones, your calculators, and that's what you're going to divide. 4480 divided by 5 is what?
896.
So we're looking for grams. So be sure to keep your units of measure intact. Okay? So we have 896 grams. And that would be answer 3 for letter C. Any questions on this? So just remember your proportions. You have to set them up and compare. Right? I think there's some other problems like this. If not, I can bring some more next week if you want more practice with proportions. Okay? You have a question? No? Okay. All right, so let's move on. So we have, All right, does anyone have any answer, or do you need another 30 seconds? No 30 seconds?
No.
Got it, okay. All right, so for number 43, it says, between which year did the largest decrease in children taking swimming lessons occur? Which one is it? Three, or C. Yes, between 1992 and 1993. And last but not least, we've got related to that chart, you have number 44. So I'm going to give you 30 seconds to do that. It says, what was the average number of children taking swim lessons from 1990 to 1995? 30 seconds. So 10 squared. It's actually 10 times 10. And in a fraction form, we have 1 over 100. Yes?
Yeah, kind of, sort of.
Right? So you simply take the top number, put it in your calculator, and divide it by your dollar. So you've got to divide your numerator by your denominator. So what do you have? Instead of 6 1/5, you have 6.2. And I'm sure you feel comfortable with that, because when you deal with decimals, it's like you're dealing with money, right? And so what do we learn? We know that we're going to cross multiply. So we have 1x, which really means x. You have a 1, you can just drop it. And then we multiply 20 times 6.2.
Right? So 5/6 is the simplest form, but 25
to raise to create an equivalent fraction, you have to use the numerator and the denominator with one number. Yeah. So, if I'm understanding your question correctly, you always have to evaluate both the numerator and the denominator. You have to evaluate both of them. You can one can't go like this one, right? So if I multiply 5 times 4, I would get 20, right? But if I multiply 6 times 4, I don't get 30, I get 24. You see what I'm saying? So both the top and the bottom have to be the same number, okay? And so that's why this is equivalent to that, okay? All right. It is 8:18. You guys ready for one more? You got enough energy? I'm going to. Okay. One more. All right, let's see what we're going to do. All right, we did 50. I'm trying to do something that doesn't burn up too many brain cells. Let me see, let's turn to the next page. So let's do something that's simple. Let's look at 61. I think that's simple. I think it's simple. 61. Which fraction is equal to 0.20%? Yeah, that wasn't. That's going to burn up a few brain cells. Sorry. You want to do one more? page 28. All right, guys. So talk to me. What did you get from 67? Four is correct. So let me ask you this. What strategy did you use in order to figure that out? So you can try to find equivalent fractions, right? I think the most direct way is to change all the fractions to decimals, right? So you're going to have calculators, right? And so just quickly, instead of running up brain cells, right? Quickly convert each of those fractions to decimals. Say it again. Divide all of them and get the decimal. And it's easier to compare decimals, in my opinion. Right? So you have, they're asking you to see which one is less than 2/3. Right? So that's your benchmark. So if we divide it 2 by 3, we get 0.666. Repeat, right? The 6 will go longer than that. And so now we have 7/8. If we divide that really quick, we get 0.875, so that's more, so that's out. We have 5/6, which is 0.833, so that's out, that's more. We have 3/4, you might go 3/4 off again, that's 0.75, so that's out. We have 3/5, that's 0.6, right? So you have to know that 2/3 and decimal form. 0.666, so we rounded it, it would be 0.67. So this 7 is more than the 0 that would be here. So this is less than 2/3. And then if you wanted to do the due diligence for 5/7, that is equal to 0.71. So we know that that is out. Okay? So again, if you're dealing with fractions, sometimes it's easier to convert it to a decimal and to do comparisons like this. Alright? So hopefully I didn't burn up too many brain cells. Yes, I'll see you guys next week. Okay. Alright, have an awesome week. I will see you on next Tuesday. And if you feel like going ahead, please do. Get as much practice and reading in as you possibly can, okay? Alright. Enjoy.